name is Carlos, and I'm the curator of the art gallery here on campus. First of all, I want to thank Pat Vine and Candace, who did a wonderful job, always providing excellent food for our students and the drama department. I want to say, Wick is a wonderful artist. I really enjoy what Wick has done with these drawings. And, when I met Wick in one of my first art classes at San Diego State University, it was a long time ago, and slowly just been seeing what he's been doing and following his career and really always enjoyed his work. And so this work that I've selected is much different from what he normally does, but I think it's just a wonderful idea, and I think I'm very proud to present it here. So I just want to say thank you very much for attending, and I hope you enjoy the lecture. We're going to have four videos, and please be patient, and Wick will also answer questions afterwards. So, and here's Wick Alexander.
So, Carlos, can you grab the lights?
Yeah.
Okay, tonight I'm proud to present the premiere show of four video works created while participating in a thematic residency on pop, sub, and mass culture at the Banff Center of the Arts in Alberta, Canada, during the winter of 1997. 60 artists from Canada, the US, Mexico, South America, and Cuba, and Europe, whose work dealt with issues that investigate culture in context, collaborated on a multitude of projects. Different languages, identities, sexual identities, and egos were the biggest obstacles among the artists at the Banff residency. About one-third of the artists were French or Spanish-speaking, and since I speak Spanish, I bonded extremely well with the Cuban, Mexican, South American, and Spanish artists. I learned a lot about Canada, too. Tonight, you will sample four video collaborations. Each one has a distinct flavor. The four video works are as follows. Finally a Kiss by Rosita Rodriguez from Peru, which runs 8 minutes. Two is Be Speechless with the Walter Ego Show by Jorge Luis Marzo from Spain, and that's 27 minutes. The third one is Each and Every One of You, How to Make Contemporary Art, Episode 2, The Weirdness Installation. And that's by Donald Goods and Anne-Marie Leger from Montreal. And the last one, my favorite, is Tell Me Things You Want to Hear by Jin Han Ko, Jin's Banana House from Toronto. So are you ready? Because here it comes. First up, Finally a Kiss, directed by Rosita Rodriguez, a Peruvian prodigy of telenovelas. Far from mellow, this melodrama shatters the peaceful little town located in the Canadian Rocky Mountains by an event which people will remember forever and ever. Es muy triste. Como yo. It is a story, a love story, contemporary and tragic. Ladies and gentlemen, finally, finally a kiss. Thank you.
Banff is a peaceful little town in the west of Canada, positioned among the imposing Rocky Mountains. The Banff residents dedicate themselves to the arduous tourist activity. Live peacefully in pretty little wood houses. The silence is only interrupted by the majestic elk that meander over Banff's serene and wooded paths. But someday, the peace will be broken by an event that all people will remember forever and ever.
This time I want to surrender to you completely.
We cannot let this moment escape.
I want to be yours for anything. It matters to us.
Would you give me a coffee, please?
Only coffee? Don't you have something to do?
Only coffee. Do I need to bring it?
No, I bring that. I feel here in my heart the remorse of my behavior.
Dearest, nothing happens.
How is it? Is natural that without your love, my kisses choose where to go?
You're a wildfire. In the fire of your own passion, you will burn yourself.
Why pretend it is possible that the heart can live without love?
to the conclusion people suffered and said, and you go out, the shadows envelop you.
But I don't go.
Don't we make you grateful? Let me see myself in your eyes.
Okay, it is my great pleasure, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, hombres y mujeres, presta atención, I would like to present to you a spectacular spectacle of magic and illusion. Tonight, we will witness a swirling soiree of sensationalism, a performance never performed by any former performer. Explosiva, fantástico, maravillosa. You are about to witness an amazing video made entirely for you to like it. In it, you will see things never seen before. Around it, you will hear rumors that are completely true. Through it, you will experience flashbacks otherwise forgotten. 25 minutes jam-packed with ventriloquism, prestidigitation, illusion, magic, and spectacle. Brought to you here at Mesa College. Ladies and gentlemen, hombres y mujeres, here tonight, directamente para Barcelona via Winnipeg, mucho macho from Jalisco, cantar en el disco, por sus borrachos gigantes, it is my pleasure to present to you live here now, right in this very moment. Be speechless.
gentlemen, let me introduce you to you all this fucking shit. Con todos ustedes, Jorge Peto and Walter Ego. I don't understand why I'm doing all this fucking shit, but everybody's welcome.
Thank you very much and welcome to this new show tonight. We are going to spend a magic time together with our guest stars and our great public, because magic is just it's all about. Aren't you excited, Walty? Aren't you excited, Walty? Aren't you excited, Walty?
Excited? Oh, what?
I can guess a touch of irony in your voice.
He guesses a touch of irony in my voice? Wonderful, because I sense a bad breath from your mouth. Constipated?
Please, Walter, don't start again. That's because I smoke. But you don't understand about these pleasures.
But I do about others. And that's because I'm excited, stupid.
Oh, I know what you mean. You need some sex, don't you? Now I got it. You had sex already. Tell us.
You are a fucking vent. How can I say something like that to one who doesn't know how to keep a secret?
Hey, we've been together for so long that you should know better.
But you can invent whatever you want. Before I know, it's a secret of mine.
Oh, geez. You woke up as an intellectual today.
Well, it's much better to have sawdust in my mind than the atrophic muscle you've got in yours.
Fuck you.
Fuck you, too.
Oh, shut up.
You shut up, motherfucker.
Fucking rotten piece of wood. Fuck off.
Fuck you and your whole fucking dead family.
Okay, okay, we gotta have a talk. But meanwhile...
And now all the shit that talks about the fucking Christ and his whole dead family. Fucking the Jesus on the Christ in the cross and all that shit.
Here we are again. You feel quieter now?
I can't believe it.
So, tell me, isn't it great that we are here in Banff enjoying the beautiful mountains in company of all these marvelous guys?
Are you paid for this shit, man?
No, we are doing it in the name of the art.
So, you're not paid for it? If not, how could you fall so down?
In life, everything is not money.
That's true. Look at yourself.
What happened with me?
You're a loser. We haven't even advertised the show. And this is the first thing a professional must do.
Okay, so you like being advertised, don't you?
Yes, I like illusions.
Oh, which kind?
The ones you end up smoking a cigarette in bed.
I understand it. That has to be an illusion to you.
No, it's an illusion for them.
Oh, the boy is so really proud.
Shut up. You don't know what you're talking about. I'm trying to speak proper English. What the fuck? You fucking guys, you make me wait so much time. You make me speak slower than I think, and I feel like I'm stupid. Be faster.
Oh, Oh, so the boy thinks that he has everything under control. Smart guy. Who's moving this arm, honey?
That's English, dear. I like you to ask me this question, because I've been researching lately on this.
Don't be pedantic.
Who's speaking now, you or me? I guess I got lost.
You.
Well, you're moving the arm that's supposed to be moved, so technically, I'm moving it. Take that.
Very well, my little doll. But if I decide to stop the arm, you can get very fucked up, don't you?
Sure. You're going to spend the entire night talking about yourself?
No, because we are devoted to our wonderful audience.
No, because you're the one who's fucked up. I'm going to speak for sure. This is my job, man, because if I don't speak, you're dead boring, and no one would listen to you. Well, anyway, you're dead boring all the time. Shut up, eating, working, or walking on the moon.
Oh, that's police.
Yes, the police, please.
Listen, I can just speak by my own, and then that's it. What do you think you are, honey? Look, you are now off. Waltie, my Benjamin. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, it's my big pleasure to introduce you an amazing living story, a legend in the world of spectacle, Antonio Abatelli, who from the most harsh childhood, when was screamed by a streetcar and got paralytic, willingly has been able to become a living hero in the American scene. Ladies and gentlemen, with you, the wonder of Antonio Abatelli.
Este amor tan fatal. Amenaza mi mente, esta fiebre de ti, estas ansias vehementes, este calor de infierno que me abraza la frente, perdonando perdón. Pero no puede ser, no, ir hacia ti sería dejar en el camino de mi vida.
I didn't remember that you were off. Oh yeah, I know what I'll do. I'm going to try to speak in your place, trying to imitate your voice and your opinions about the master Abatelli, so you will convince yourself that you are not so important as you think.
I liked it a lot. I think I learned from this painful experiences. Experiences are very important in life, and we should share them in order to create new values in society that's falling apart. Because what we lived is something valuable to others. Let's put the example of my grandmother. I'm doing an installation on it. She came from Russia as a pioneer and settled down near Winnipeg.
Okay, you win. I need you somehow. You are the funny guy, not me. Someone has to do it. Oh, Okay. Now you don't want to talk, because the baby is very sensitive. It's impossible to carry on a conversation with you. Oh, you're getting cold.
You don't pay me enough for this shit, man. Of course you need me. I told you, if I shut up, you're nothing. And if I speak, you're nothing either. Because people's only interested in what I say. Your job is simply to give a touch of credibility, which is quite paradoxical, because who's going to believe you, man?
So, I know some people that trust me, and I do too with respect to them. For example, our sponsors. They're doing a good job for us to be here and for helping artists to focus properly their careers. So, stay tuned.
Fucking tune. Tell me much more stupid stories about this fucking shit called real life. I cheat on God.
thoughts, have a certain sound.
So we were talking about magic and illusion. Isn't it great when kids are so amazed before a show?
It's pathetic.
Why are you so nasty with poor kids?
Because they think I'm a doll.
Well, that's exactly what you are.
Oh, but tell me who I am. Just the one who makes you understandable? But the worst thing is that you are so simple that my job is totally unworthy. So that's the real illusion, to make you appear a little bit interesting.
We'll talk about all these things later, but now let's take a look on the real illusionist strip. Are you ready for a heavy experience? We are going to enter in the so-called virtual reality. Woo!
You are so stupid. I'm virtual reality, man.
Don't complain so much. There we go. That's fantastic.
My video games are a lot better.
Don't be stupid. This is art.
So what's it for? Just to take a look on it? Fucking boring.
Look at this. What do you think has been the intention of the artist doing this so?
To make you talk about it. Especially if you consider it really fantastic.
Well, yes, I do. I think it's great. Viva la realidad virtual.
Viva tu puta madre.
Oh, what does it mean?
It's a sunny day.
Don't you think it's wonderful to live in a dream like that?
After many years of working in this stupid biz, I realized something. There's nothing more exciting, but also more dangerous, than living in others' dreams. So hurry up and turn the TV off now, because no one stands this, and I got an important date tonight.
Really? What a surprise.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, another fucking commercial from our stupid sponsor. I just want to come back to my burning house. Pinche pendejo de la gran chingada.
Did you like the show today? I think our audience is happy. Are you all happy?
It's amazing how people can be manipulated.
No way. They're here because they like the show.
In any case, they're here because they like hearing themselves in TV.
But people at home don't hear themselves in the TV set.
But they hear themselves through me.
You are so pedantic.
Well, there's no pedantic in TV. It's simply impossible. Well, that's not true. You are, and you look like pedantic.
That's because you feel jealous of my skill.
How can I be jealous of your skills if I am your main skill? They are me, and I am them, because I'm saying what they're not supposed to say.
Oh, so a job is a sort of pedagogical commitment.
No, because if I say fuck them, they'll clap wildly, finding it very funny.
So?
Definitely, you are stupid. They like to be insulted in TV because they feel I'm insulting them as a whole. Not one by one, but nobody wants to believe it.
That's not true at all, Waltie. I believe you, my dear.
That's my biggest problem, that you believe all I say. That's the tragedy of my life and my bank account.
Oh, please. Cut off this fucking shit. I can't stand it anymore. Fuck you both and go to hell at once. I can't bear this fucking shit, you fucking jerks.
Okay. Time to go, Waltie. Do you want to say something now?
Fuck them.
So, that's all, folks. I wish you had a wonderful time with us. We'll see you all the next week with more funny things. And you know, this show is entirely made for you to like it. See you guys!
This isn't what we talked about at all. The script you gave me last week is completely different.
Either way, we can keep them on track, you know. Look at him. You should just pick up your fucking nose!
Excellent. All right, let's get to how to make contemporary installation art. Let's follow Andy to find out the recipe for creating successful contemporary installation art. He'll take us to the studio and then travel through the world of art history and then walk us through installation process step by step from concept to completion in just 32 minutes. Ladies and gentlemen, I am proud to present to each and every one of you, the Weirdness Installation.
Contemporary installation art is easy to do.
Each and every one of you, contemporary installation art, each and every one of you. Hello, friends. I'm here to prove to you that each and every one of you can make contemporary installation art. Now, you've all seen those shows where a painter will demonstrate how to paint a landscape with birch trees, a mirror lake, and some fluffy clouds. Well, on each and every one of you, we're talking contemporary art, contemporary installation art. In the next half hour, you'll follow us as we make an installation we call the Weirdness Installation. Each week, a different installation. This week, the Weirdness Installation. This is going to be funky, I can tell you that much. Now, you may know that famous art instructor from the 1950s, who was on television way back then. Well, he taught us that there are four basic but powerful forms that go into the drawing of any subject, whether that be a mine worker or a ferocious cougar. Everything can be broken down into these four basic forms, and they are the cube, the sphere, the cone, and the cylinder. Now, for contemporary art that we make on this show, we've updated the basic forms into what we call the four basic installation art directives, the four things that go into the making of all our installations. Now, what are they? Well, number one, you must take a stand. Directly stand. You have to position yourself in relation to the world. Number two, you have to make aesthetic decisions. This is about color, form, light, composition. Number three, you must develop the concept, all that stuff that goes around in your head, you know? And finally, the directive number four, make the work. Go ahead. That's our fourth directive. As you make more and more installations with us, you're going to get to know these installation art directives like, well, kind of like how you know the sound of a crinkly plastic chocolate wrapper being crushed under your foot as you walk down the streets of Manhattan on a rainy evening. Yeah, kind of as well as you know that. And you know, you'll be surprised how the installation art directors will slowly help you build a foundation for a new appreciation of the world. Today's installation, the Weirdness Installation, what's it going to involve? Well, there's a huge stuffed dog that's huge, I'm telling you, with a video monitor, a videotape television show thingamajig in its tummy with an experimental video kind of thing on it. There's going to be also some lint scattered around the ground and a few other crazy things. Very strange, don't you think? Well, don't touch that remote control. Get ready for weirdness and to have some fun. Let's make contemporary art. Welcome to the studio on today's Weirdness Installation. As always, we begin our work by taking a stand. This is our first basic installation art directive. Today's stand dates way back to the beginning of the century when European avant-garde artists attacked taboos and traditions. So, listen up. Okay, this is our stand. We decided to bring out the weirdness in some things from our culture that are supposed to be strictly associated with happy, happy, pleasant things. It's kind of like, it's kind of like dropping a pink candy floss in a mud puddle. Yeah. So what we do is we force ourselves to look at and get to know something that might at best seem totally insignificant and at worst totally useless. A most invigorating exercise. By working out these difficult associations in our installation, we want to master them. Yeah. So they're no longer shocking to us, because they're part of our world. So, in this way, we fulfill our directive to take a stand. We're going to look straight at weirdness and make it part of us, make it normal. Okay, what materials do we need for the weirdness installation? Well, conveniently, we need a huge stuffed animal. Just the kind of thing that you might have won at the fair for your boyfriend or girlfriend. Okay, so a huge stuffed animal. We also need a little stuffed animal. This is the kind of thing that you find at a thrift shop. And when you're going through the stuffed animal bin, you find one and then you go, that is the weirdest thing I've ever seen. That would be perfect for installation. You need things to dirty up this stuffed animal, especially our big one. We're going to manipulate it with some scissors and some charcoal, a very common artist material, a felt pen. We need lint, okay? Lint. A piece of cardboard. Yes. We're going to make a video in our installation, so we need a camcorder with a cassette and a fully charged battery. We need a script. This is our script. It's a list of baby sounds. Okay. A VCR and a cassette to play back our video on, and a television. Oh, I'm forgetting something. A vacuum cleaner. So we need a shop vac or a vacuum cleaner. Those are the materials for today's installation, I think. I think I've covered everything. Okay, so there you have it. Now we're going to go on to the next part of our installation. What was it again? Oh, yes. What we do is we're going to talk about the aesthetic decisions that went into today's installation. Your ears should perk right up because this part of our installation is going to happen elsewhere. Our first installation, our directive, is make aesthetic decisions. Oh, this is our second installation, our directive. Okay, anyways, we're going to make aesthetic decisions. Okay, and to do this, as we do every week, we're going to take a flying leap out of the studio into the art of the past. Welcome to the world of art history, the world of aesthetic decisions. Oh, hey, that's a urinal. What a stink. Oh. So anyways, whew, just like Duchamp here, you know what he did? He took his urinal, turned it upside down, and called it his own art. Just like Duchamp, our first aesthetic decision is to take a manufactured object and use it in our creation. That happens a lot in contemporary art. Now, we didn't design this found object, but we do manipulate it. It kind of changes the context. It always remains recognizable, but, like I said, the context is altered. We want the object to be big, okay? So that it's kind of oversized and grabs your attention. We didn't want the manufactured object to look new. No way. We want it to be soiled, worn, like it has a lot of history to it. Kleinfeld here is the real master of that. Gives you the shudders. Okay, one ready-made object isn't enough. We need another. This one is similar to the first, but much smaller. It attracts our attention because it's strange. Like this Abramovich here, our next aesthetic decision is to add another element to the composition. This other element is the video tape. It's playing on the television. It contrasts with those two ready-made I've already talked about because it's a moving image with sound, and they're static, so there's a contrast there. Now, we want the look of the video to be very rough, kind of raw, experimental style. Not like our slick television show here on each and every one of you. Okay, we also wanted the video to be of the human body, but just one small part of it. We use a kind of super close-up, so you're confronted with just that fragment of the body. Finally, we feel that our installation needs something to kind of connect all those different parts together and intensify the limits. And you know, what we did is we decided that this element was to be on the floor, kind of surround the piece with rope. With that element. Surround it, everything. And, as is the case with most installations, the piece occupies the same space as the viewer. We put it in the middle of the room. Well, that's it for the aesthetic decision. Back to the sordid den of creation. That was one refreshing fly through art history. Whoa, looks like the studio assistant has been in here to help us prepare for the next part of our installation. It's time to ease our way into making the work. A crucial directive, make the work, make the work, make the work, work the make, the. You know, sorry about that. Voyaging through all that old art can sometimes have strange effects on the mind. Okay. As is our custom, we will be discussing the develop the concept directive as we create our work. The third and fourth directive discussed at once. Okay, so put on your work gloves and your thinking caps. We are in production. Woohoo! I have my dog here. And what are we going to start with? Well, we're going to start with dirtying the sucker up a bit more. I'm going to use my felt pen a bit. Okay. What else could we use a little dirt? Rub it in a bit. Very common art technique, charcoal and rubbing. Maybe we should start working with some other art-making tools. This thing here has definitely got to go. You can rip it for a more natural effect as well. And every stuffed animal in the world that's ever been through a great life always has an ear missing. Call the doctor. Okay. Dagnabbit. Too much glue on the side.
What did that poor dog ever do to you?
Pardon me?
What did that poor dog ever do to you?
Why, this mass-produced object, stuffed with styrofoam and sewn by poor workers in sweatshops in Taiwan, it's not real. By the way, this is the concept part. Of course, though, we must admit that on the other hand, it's easy to project sentimental meaning onto all the toy animals that exist. They're designed to evoke a sense of innocence, joy, comfort, all those ideal childhood feelings. Yet at the same time, we all know how oppressive all those expectations are that say that we must perpetually live a smiley, happily ever after existence, denying that sadness, anger, or even the deep, deep wounds exist. It's downright sick. By attacking a dog, what we do is we refuse this false, unfulfillable expectation. A tension is created in the work. A tension between our desire to have a nice, clean puppy just make us feel good, and our realization that it's in its pathetic state, the dog embodies our more hurt feelings. So that's all part of the concept. I'm going to just try and do a little more work here. I've got to get this eye out. And both of these things should go. There. That's excellent. That's what it needed. Thank you. Okay, in contemporary art, you often have to roll with the punches. I said that before. You know, we had to upgrade our vacuum. That's done. and I think we're going to be set now. So, time for the incision. We're going to make a cut into the belly. To do this, I have my piece of cardboard here, shaped perfectly to receive the television. With the felt pen, I'm going to draw a little line here, and this is going to tell us exactly where to make our hole. As well, the cardboard is going to act as a kind of dam to keep all the styrofoam from rushing into the center. Now, try and follow the line carefully. It's very important. All right. Up over here. Now, before we do anything else, we're going to carefully insert our piece of cardboard into the space. And it fits perfectly, of course. There we go. Whoops, just get that corner in. So this is what's going to receive our television. Okay. Now I'm going to tape up these edges here. And we have a little bit of taping to do down here, I think. Tape right over that styrofoam. And one more. Same to cover up. And you might be thinking, well, isn't that tape kind of ugly there? Yes, it is. It's very ugly. And that's good. Okay. Tape along the top part here. This is a weirdness installation. Get weird. Time to hit the suction. All right. Let's go with this. Suction on. All right. Bring that hose down a little to the left. Woo-hoo. Keep it coming, keep it coming. Slow but sure. Sucking it back. Ah, this is working fine. I see land. Yes. There's nothing pretty about this. Nothing pretty at all. We just have to go down inside now and get her capped off in there. Keep the suction coming. That was pretty exciting. Okay, now we're going to fit our television in. There it is. And this goes quite nicely, I might add, into our hole. Television in the belly. No, that worked out quite nice. Gently, gently. Very nice. Okay. I'm going to just take a moment to prop the dog up and clean up our studio a bit. So let's just do that. Getting really excited about the piece. We're ready now to make our video, the weirdness video. It's really easy to make. You begin with your list of baby sounds. This acts as your script. Now, it's really important that you have a wide range of these baby sounds. Don't be slack. You can't just make them up from memory. It's best if you hang around a real baby. We're looking for authenticity here, okay? And if you don't have a real baby in the family, well, go to the shopping mall and eavesdrop on someone, something like that. There's usually a lot of babies in the shopping mall. Okay, we have our list here. Now that we have our script, we need an actor. We need an actor to play in the video.
Hey, hello, Andy.
And
how are
Marie?
You doing? I heard you need somebody to play in your video.
Well, you came at a perfect moment. We're just starting to shoot.
Right.
Can you take a look at the script here and try and memorize some of these lines? I'm just going to tell everybody kind of what they should do to get that perfect look for the video.
All right.
Okay, the first thing you have to make sure of is that there's plenty of light in the room. Okay. Now, the second thing I want to tell you about is the macro function. You're going to have to read your manual to see how this works on your particular camera, but this lets you do super close-up. Okay, the depth of field is really small, so things go out of focus really easy. But that's okay, because that's the experimental style we're looking for. So you're gonna do these quick shots, okay? Anne-Marie?
Yep.
Are you ready?
Ready.
Okay. We're rolling.
Go.
Perfect.
Good?
That's excellent.
Okay.
Okay, just a few more, okay?
All right. Is that weird enough?
Just finish this now. It's perfect. I think we got everything we need down now. Okay?
Right.
You look like you're in a hurry to leave, so...
Yeah, I have something to do.
Okay, I'll let you go.
Okay, thanks.
Thanks a lot.
Thanks a million. Bye.
Okay, so the video that you do should be about 2 minutes long or something like that. You can repeat it over and over on the VHS, which you're going to transfer this to. And actually, that's what I'm going to do right now. I'm going to go transfer this to my VHS deck. Okay? Oh, hi. I'm back here working out the electronics of the piece. Got our video transferred onto the VHS. I put it on a few times, like I said I was going to do. We do that because when people come to see the piece, then we don't have to be always rewinding the VCR. Okay, I'm just going to pop that in there and connect the VCR and plug in the television. Okay, like these cords here that you can see, that's good. Keep them there. It gives a nice aura to the piece. Chords in contemporary art are definitely an aesthetic pleasure. Okay, let's play the video. Check it out. Check out the piece. Away. Let's go, man. Oh, that is really, really weird.
How could those strange baby sounds relate to the concept, Sandy?
They relate perfectly. What they do is they reinforce all the concepts that we talked about earlier. In the extreme close-ups you got here, you can see the mouths, the wrinkles, the saliva. In the tongue, there's something frighteningly human about them. Isn't there? Frighteningly human. We don't want to put on makeup. We don't want to airbrush it. We don't want to put on deodorant. We want them to stink and age. They're so real, I'm telling you. So, a baby sounds here. You know what? They're more true than the ones you see in the movies. They're more authentic. They're sometimes more visceral. The sounds related to pain, sounds related to hurting. Not just always happy, pleasure sounds. Sometimes they're downright rude. Now, see an adult mouth making the sounds that a baby makes reminds us that we all began without words and grammar, without language. And as much as language helped us when we were kids, it also cut us off from a more full emotional life, So those are some of the concepts of the word. You know, I gotta see the piece finished. I'm gonna go over here and get this lint. Just spread this out. Oh, that looks perfect. And now, the last piece. Our little, weird, stuffed animal.
What role do the little stuffed animals and lint play?
Well, we felt that we needed a small, tortured, stuffed animal that looked pathetic because, well, it was kind of like we wanted it to feel like it had been saved from the garbage after being loved to death. You know what I mean? It's like part of the concept. It's a point of entry into the piece. All kinds of subconscious feelings just make their way and flow into this part of the piece. The lint echoes the same kind of reading. It's made of fibers that were once considered useful, parts of towels, clothing, slacks, blouses, but now it's become garbage. It was functional, then it lost its function. In the artwork, it regains its meaning, its symbolic meaning. You know, art's great for that. It can give meaning to practically everything. Okay, so the installation looks very weird, don't you think? I love the sound. And this is good. It's inspiring to us. I'm going to give you a little break from the studio now. You probably need it. And let you peek in on the next item up for sale on the Art Shopping Channel.
Okay, folks, our next item up for auction on Home Art Shopping Channel is something lovely, titled Somewhere Else by Elizabeth Lemoyne, dated 95-96.
Now, Elizabeth Lemoyne is a Canadian artist, although she makes her home in England. And this adorable little objet d'art is made of chemo and fabric and other mixed media.
And it's starting out at a lovely low $79.99.
That,
so call
in.
That
is a steal. That is a steal at $79.99. And somebody has recognized that because the price has already jumped to $358.98. Now, this piece is... It's a small
piece. Hold the fan. It's actually going up to $370.99.
Oh, my goodness. That's excellent.
As you were saying?
It's well worth that. This piece is a series of hands in different gestures taken from religious paintings from the Renaissance and before. And it includes a miniature airline chair, which is actually tipped over.
In repose, actually.
In repose, exactly. And...
Hold up. $407.99. Call in.
Oh, and now it's jumping to $499.99. Excellent. Somebody out there definitely understands the value of good art. Now, this kind of a piece can go in any room in your house. I could envision it in a bedroom, on a coffee table, even in the kitchen on your counter.
It's obviously a lovely coffee table discussion.
Definitely. And, Lyle, the price has now jumped to $699.
Actually, $1,099.
I think that's fabulous. It's really, it's an attractive piece. It's interesting. It's guaranteed to raise conversation at every party you have. And here comes the price again, $1,285.99. It's astounding. People are really just calling in left and right.
Well, I think that's it. So it ends with
$1,285.99.
Exquisite.
You know, it's great to see people buy art. It makes me feel all warm inside. Well, we finished our piece. I'm going to clear out the studio so we can get a good look at it. So, our piece here, the Weirdness Installation, stands homage to the difficult feelings we all carry with us from our early years. We take the chaos associated with those feelings and make them into art. In doing so, we normalize them. Weirdness is no longer weirdness, it's normal. The feelings are art now.
Andy?
Oh!
Hi.
Hi.
May I come in?
Yeah, come on in.
Actually, I was watching you while you were putting the installation, so
it
was
very interesting. Can I introduce you to everybody? This is Katharina. Katharina is a cultural theorist, hey?
Yes.
So you were watching?
Yeah, I was watching and I jotted a few notes down. I don't know if you're interested.
Oh,
I'd
love to.
You know, it's very raw.
We'd love to hear it.
To really work them through.
No,
but
no.
When I watched you install the piece,
uh-huh.
one quote kept coming into my mind in a way has sort of framed my thinking.
Okay,
and
what
was
that?
It's a quote from Georges Bataille.
Okay.
And I mean, the quote is, human life is still bestially concentrated in the mouth. And, I mean, do you see that? You
know,
we have the beast, and we have, you know, the mouth there,
yeah,
and the
yeah.
kids screaming and everything.
Uh-huh.
I think it's an appropriate way to frame the piece.
Huh.
And also, what I saw here, I saw the birth of the symbolic from a materiality that it was evacuated and then made visible at the same time. You know, the mouth and all the gibberish, blah, blah, gaga, and all that.
Uh-huh.
And you really succeeded in demonstrating the pre-symbolic materiality of the body.
Oh, thanks.
Am I going too fast for you?
No, okay. Go on.
And also, I found it very interesting that you managed to control the excessive desire of the body
uh-huh.
by actually, you know, by giving priority to
yeah.
technology.
Actually,
like,
I should speed up.
Okay. Like you have the vacuum cleaner and the television and everything.
Uh-huh.
So you managed through the use of this to really appropriate the belly and the mouth. And the only thing I have problem with, I mean, the belly and the mouth, they are most, you know, archaic sexual organs and sort of you can use them up to the technology. Okay.
We're
out of
time.
Maybe another
now.
Time?
Yeah, maybe we could talk about those things
okay.
over coffee.
Okay, I would like that very much.
Okay. We'll hold that idea, okay?
Okay.
Okay, so I'll see you later, Katrina. Thanks a lot for dropping by the studio.
Okay, bye, Andy.
We always love when the critics drop by.
Bye-bye.
Katrina. Okay, so there you have it. We worked together today through the four installation art directives. Here's what they are. One, taking a stand. Two, make aesthetic decisions. Three, developing a concept. And four, make the work. Now, the result is today's wonderful, weird installation. You know, before we leave, I think that Anne-Marie has a letter from our listeners. So I am going to scoot over to the living room. Hi, Anne-Marie.
Well, hello, Andy. That was a pretty weird installation.
Well, mighty fine of you to say so.
It was good.
Thanks.
So we do have a fax today from Mr. Kelly.
Okay.
Who is actually a president of a big corporation, you know, and he's also a big fan of our show.
Good combination.
So you want to hear what he said?
You bet.
It is. Dear each and every one of you, I have been making installation with you for quite some time. Every room in my spacious home has some kind of installation in it, and I'm beginning to acquire a collection of installations by famous international artists from the company I work for.
Wow, great.
With the art I've made with you, I must now really know. Am I an artist?
Ooh, there is a man in distress. Don't worry, Mr. Kelly, you are not an artist. It's true that all of us can have a critical life and can have a creative life as well. But in the sense that you're using it, Mr. Kelly, you are definitely not an artist. It's not because you're copying the works on each and every one of you. No, copying is a respected way of making contemporary art. The reason that you're not an artist is because being an artist is like a profession, say, and it's a huge commitment. To be a real artist, you have to work to get recognition from the public and your peers who support you. And you have to develop a way to get that recognition. Well, how do we do that? You have to work as an artist within the conventions of the art world, okay? But you also have to be intelligently original. So the conventions and originality, they are the foundations contemporary art. Now, Mr. Kelly, rest assured, you are definitely involved in art, and that is great for the practice. But we'll never call you an artist. I'm not an artist for that matter. I'm just the host. So, until next week, we encourage you to keep going to see art shows in your community. And, you know, maybe they'll even run into you or I or Mr. Kelly.
And that would be weird.
Definitely. And don't forget, each and every one of you can make contemporary installation art. Until next week, bye-bye. And we'll be back with another installation as usual.
Bueno,
so take care and see you next week.
Bye now.
Bye-bye.
Contemporary installation art is easy to do.
Each and every one of you. Contemporary installation art. Each and every one of you, temporary inspiration art. Each and every one of you, temporary inspiration art. Each and every one of you, temporary
inspiration art. Contemporary.
Okay, and finally, last but not least, there's something here for everyone. Are you ready? Well, get ready, because here it comes. Jin's Banana House presents Tell Me Things You Want to Hear.
Hey,
are great. It's so good. So excellent. That's so great. That's so excellent. That's so excellent. Man, that's so exciting. Wow, man, that's so great. Man, so exciting. So great. So good. So good, man. Whew. Yeah, that's so great. Man, that's so great. So great. So good. Yeah, so exciting. Wow, that's so great. That's so fantastic. So excellent. So excellent. So great, man. So great. That's so good. So good. So great. Yeah. For sure, man. Wow. So great. So excellent. So excellent. Yeah. So great. Wow, that's so great. So excellent. So excellent. Whew, so great. So good. So excellent. That's so excellent. So excellent, man. So great. Man, that's great. That is great. That's excellent. Wow, that's great. That's excellent. So good, so good. So excellent. So great.
Thank you very much. So great. So excellent. Because it was so excellent. It was just sort of like a simple idea. How could it get any better? And it's sort of something that everybody wants to hear is all there. How do you tie the work to the videos? Well, the videos are basically another way to talk about issues. The collaborations that where I fit into these four pieces is kind of a complex story, but it's not a really easy answer. They fit in because they're humorous. They fit in because, to me they seem like they're an extension of my work. I did a lot of videotapes in graduate school. And then I decided that really in order to focus on one particular aspect, which would be painting, took all my time. So the opportunity at Banff came up, and so I was able to sort of get back into videotapes. I was involved in the setup and shooting, and we sort of talked about the ideas. And he sort of has his method of directing his own work. So I was involved, but not. I wasn't really saying you have to say it 55 times or whatever.
It was supposed to go with your thesis in the show.
Well, we set it up. It was sort of a joke. We set it up so that I had a painting in the background of mine that I was working on. And he was looking at the painting, you know, saying, so excellent. Right, yeah. So good.
So if you were to install it with your work, you would almost kind of set him up facing that painting.
Right, mm-hmm. Yeah.
That would be so excellent.
Yeah. Be so excellent.
Yeah. Why didn't you?
Well, it took, you know, I think it was a piece that stands by itself because it has sort of broader meaning rather than to bring it in on my own work. Well, here's another story about that is that his work is a lot about setting up the camera as a static camera. And there's an earlier piece that we did together, and the idea was he set the camera up on a road and was gonna ride a bike up the hill. Meanwhile, as he was riding the bike up the hill, there was a bus that went by and it totally eclipsed him riding the bike. So he's riding the bike, he got eclipsed by the bus. The bus, you know, parallel parked and then went back. And so since you didn't see him, he kept the camera on. And a series of Japanese tourists that were in this tour bus all got out, walked over to the side, and all took their picture, and then all went back into the bus, all in this one shot. And so it was a sort of piece of magic that happened. Yeah. Excellent. Any questions? Yeah, that was part of my contribution as well to the Walter Ego show, was I was the voice of the dummy. And we dubbed my voice in there as the dummy. Practiced and got it down. And did the laugh track as well. So. What's next? I'm going to be doing ice sculpture. No. Actually, I am doing sculpture now, so I've given up on painting. No.
Okay.
So, any more questions? Cliff.
Where did you come up with all these pieces?
That's a good question. The short story is that the work was generated from, if anyone read the artist statement, it started by me kind of coming across some graffiti that I saw, and the graffiti was very rough, and it was sort of drawn by what I would guess would be a male teenager, and it said, "Someone stole my brain," and it had a cartoon character of sort of the head cut off, and it wasn't exactly like I've appropriated it. And then that led to some other ideas. I had my house broken into, and I had my television. I had a whole list of things that were stolen out of the house. So sort of as a retaliation, I created this body of work. You know, someone stole my, you know, television. Someone stole my VCR. Someone stole my leather jacket, my Nikes, you know, everything that was stolen. And then then I started thinking about how instead of someone stole my television, to sort of begin to superimpose television stole my blank. This all sort of filtered for a while. And then during the Banff residency, one of the things that was kind of surprising to me was how the artists in the residency were able to bond by their criticism and complaints and blaming things. So I did this series based on blame, and I started out the series Banff stole my sleep, Banff stole my appetite, you know, et cetera, everything that the artists were complaining about, which was sort of the thing that bonded them as artists. And then it became something more like an exercise. It became almost like a machine. The work started to generate itself. Other people started giving me ideas about the Stolmai. One of my friends up there, you know, came up. She was very excited. She goes, "I got a great one." She goes, "You know, so lesbians stole my batteries." You know, she's a lesbian artist, and you know, it was like one I couldn't have come up with on my own. Okay, thank you very much.